Wednesday night. So a lot of people missing tonight. But I tell you what's not missing. And that's the presence of God.
Oh, yes.
I said that's what's not missing. Hallelujah. I'm glad I came to the house of the Lord tonight. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I knew there would be something special waiting for us here. Amen. I'm glad that I showed up, but I'm glad most of all that God showed up. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Turning your attention tonight to the word of the Lord, the book of Acts, the 27th chapter. I am still feasting on what the Lord did around here Sunday morning, Sunday night. Amen. Wasn't it beautiful, the presence and the power of God that we felt Sunday morning and Sunday night? Everybody I've talked to since Sunday evening, I've told them about what a wonderful, wonderful Sunday that God gave us. Pastor preaching on it's contagious, and I believe that Sunday night it was contagious. Amen. Something broke loose in this place Sunday night. Amen. What a beautiful, beautiful word of God we heard Sunday morning, and then the worship that you participated in Sunday night for 45, 50 minutes, just total worship before the Lord. That was beautiful. And Brother Stan challenging us to go that little extra. Amen. And I believe we went that little extra on Wednesday, Sunday night. Amen. And so we need to do the same thing on this Sunday night. We need to go a little extra tonight. Praise God. God has more for us. I said God has more for us. Praise God. Amen. Turning your attention to the word of the Lord tonight, the book of Acts, the 27th chapter. Begin reading in verse number 13. And when the south wind blew softly, supposing that they had obtained their purpose loosening thence, they sailed close to Crete. But not long after there arose against it a tempestuous wind called Euroclydon. And when the ship was caught and could not bear up into the wind, we let her drive. And running under a certain island, which is called Clauda, we had much work to come by the boat, which when they had taken up, they used helps, undergirding the ship, fearing lest they should fall into the quicksand, strake sail, and so were driven. And we being exceedingly tossed with a tempest, the next day they lightened the ship. The third day we cast out with our own hands the tackling of the ship. And when neither sun nor stars in many days appeared, and no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we should be saved was taken away. But after long abstinence, Paul stood forth in the midst of them and said, sirs, you should have hearkened unto me and not have loosed from Crete to have gained this harm and lost. And now I exhort you to be of good cheer, for there shall be no loss of any man's life among you, but of the ship. And everybody said, praise the Lord. Why don't we lift our hands and our hearts toward the Lord one more time? Let's ask him to talk to us tonight. Gracious God, we're so thankful for your goodness. We're thankful for your power, for your might tonight. We're thankful that we know you, that we're able to call upon the greatest name, the name of Jesus. Thank you for what you're doing in this house tonight. Thank you for your presence that's here. Thank you for lives that are here ready to be touched by you. Talk to us tonight, God, and we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. And everybody said in Jesus' name. Why don't we put our hands together and give him a good hand clap of praise before we're seated tonight. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Glory to God. God bless you. You may be seated in the name of Jesus. We are on our third lesson on this Wednesday night concerning riding out the storm. Everybody say riding out the storm. You find that sometimes that all that you can do when you're in the midst of the storm is just ride it out. And you find that a lot of times our attitude toward the storm determines our altitude. It determines the outcome of what is going to take place. Well, preacher, I'm not in a storm right now. That's okay. That's okay, because you're going to be in one. Found that there's three types of people. That there's some that are going through a storm right now. There's some that's about to go through a storm. Or there's those that have just come through a storm. So there's three types of people. You're either in one, you just come out of one, or you're about to go in one. Well, that's not very encouraging. No, but it's the truth. I said it's the truth. Hallelujah. You find that fear a lot of times begins to grip our minds and our hearts when we're inside the middle of a storm or within the middle of a storm. Fear, we have found, is false evidence appearing real. The devil will make us think that things are a whole lot worse than what they are. He'll make things appear to be a whole lot worse than what they are. He'll make it look like that we're going down, that we're on our last leg, that we might as well throw up our hands in despair and throw in our towel and say, look, we're giving up. But let me tell you, it's not time to give up. It's time to hold on and let God have his way. Hallelujah. You find that faith over fear takes you through the storm. It's faith over fear that takes you through the storm. Throughout the Word of God, we find where that there are whole chapters that are dedicated to people, individuals in the Word of God that are going through a storm in their life. We talk about Job. We talk about Daniel. We talk about the Hebrew boys. We talk about many, many others. Joseph, that you will find, that was going through a storm, through different storms in their life. You find their attitude during the storm. You find how intense the storm was. You find how bad that the storm was. But you find also that if they stayed true to God, and they did, if they trusted in God, that God always brought them through the storm. Can I tell someone tonight, if you're in the middle of a storm, just hang on and let God take care of things, and you'll come through the storm on the other side. Amen. The storm has never been intended to harm you. The storm is never intended to destroy you. But you find that the storm makes us stronger and helps us understand that God is with us wherever we're at. Amen. Why is it that God would take almost an entire chapter in the Word of God and tell you about a storm or a ship that was caught in the middle of a storm? Why is it that God will take almost a whole chapter and deal with the fact that all hope, and this isn't my words, this is the Word of God, it says that all hope was taken away that they might be saved. You find that if there was anything that could have saved them, the Apostle Paul deals with it and talks about lightening the ship. It talks about undergirding the ship. It talks about all these different things that they did in those few verses to try to save themselves. Sometimes we've got to understand that God's the only one that can get us out of the mess that we're in. Amen. He's the one. It's more than just history, but God has taken the story and he's made a tremendous, incredible spiritual application for you and for I. You find that some storms God keeps us from. Some storms God saves us out of. And then there's some storms God takes us through. Amen. You find that we are to never allow the presence of a storm to cause us to doubt the presence of God. Amen. Say that with me. Never allow the presence of a storm to take, well, there you go. You had it better than I do. Never allow the presence of a storm to cause you to doubt the presence of God. Amen. Never allow the presence of a storm cause you to doubt the presence of God. There's basically three things about storms that we need to understand. And number one is the reason for these storms. Number two, the reaction of ourselves, or the reaction of people in these storms. And thirdly, the result of the storms in the lives of people. You find that there are four basic reasons for storms, the reason that storms come into our lives. Number one, it's just a normal, natural storm of life. In Matthew, the 5th chapter and the 45th verse, we read last week, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven, for he maketh his sun to rise up on the evil and the good, and sendeth rain on the just and the unjust. Can I tell you tonight the reason we've had all the rain the last couple of days, yesterday and today? It's not because God has frowned upon us and so he's trying to send a flood our way. It's just simply that it's life. It's a tropical depression that came up in the Gulf, and the clouds are filled with rain. And the Bible says, just as the sun riseth on the just and the unjust, so does the rain fall on the just and the unjust. In other words, we're both going to get wet. It's just life. Don't try to spiritualize everything that happens in your life. Well, you have a horrible dream one night. Well, it's God telling me that bad things are going to come my way. No, it could be the Mexican food you ate the night before. Amen. Don't try to spiritualize everything. You had a dream of good things are coming. Well, hang on to that, child of God. Good times are coming. Amen. But it could be that there's a storm coming also. Well, I dreamed of a big, long, black snake. Well, you know, I did too, and I got the gun and blew its head off. Amen. I don't like snakes. There's three types of snakes I don't like. I don't like live ones. I don't like dead ones. I don't like sticks that look like snakes. Amen. So, if there's a snake around me, if I'm on the lawnmower, and Brother Stan told me that one day that he'd heard a story about a man that ran over a snake and it wrapped around and threw it up on the deck with him. Tell you what, if that ever happens, you're gonna see how fast I can move. Because I don't like snakes. And there's not a space big enough for me and snakes. Amen. I don't care if it's a king snake or a queen snake. I don't like any of them. Don't like them. But you find that some storms of life are just normal, natural storms. Some financial difficulties that we have are just normal, natural. Some sickness that we have is just normal and natural. It doesn't mean that you're doing everything wrong. It doesn't mean that everything is against you. It just basically means that you're having a normal life. Things are going to happen. Bad things happen to good people sometimes. Amen. The second reason for storms in our life is storms that are engineered by our disobedience and our foolishness. We talked about Jonah. We talked about how that a storm came up in Jonah's life. You can read in the book of Jonah how that he chose to get on the ship was it Tarsus? Ship to Tarsus. And he got on that ship and a storm came up and it was so bad that he said, you know what? I'm the reason for this storm. It's because of my disobedience that it's put all of you in the middle of the storm. He said, throw me overboard. And they threw him overboard. And he was swallowed by a great fish, the Bible talks about. And you know how the Bible talks about in the belly of the fish. The Bible talks about how that he repented. And he turned his heart back toward God. Can I tell you, even in our darkest situations, I'm glad that there's an answer to our problem, and it's always Jesus. He's always able to help us. Amen. Amen. Normal storms of life. Storms engineered by our disobedience and our foolishness. The third reason for storms. The storms that God allows for our development. You find in Matthew, the 14th chapter, the 22nd verse, and straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him unto the other side while he sent the multitudes away. The whole thing, the whole reason that they were to get into the ship was to go to the other side. And Jesus even told them, he said, I'm going to meet you on the other side. I'm going to be there also when you get there. Can I tell us tonight that there are some storms that are meant for our development? It creates a spirit of faith within us. It lets us know that God is always going to be there for us. Paul said, God, he said, his grace is sufficient for me. In other words, it's not something that I can just gain right now, but it's something that God's grace is always going to be there for me to glean from. Be a partaker of. He prayed three times, let this thorn depart from me. This thorn in my flesh, remove it, God. And you find that many, many different commentators talk about what the thorn was. Some say, and I'm just going to be honest with you, some say it was his wife. Some say that it was his bent over statue. There's others that say other things. I don't know what it was. Paul didn't tell us what it was. He just said he had a thorn in his flesh. Can I tell you tonight? He prayed. The Bible says he prayed three times. And the thorn did not leave. It did not. It was still there. And God finally told him, he said, my grace is sufficient for thee. Can I tell you, God cannot give you grace for somebody else's problem, but he can give you grace for your own problem. Can't give you peace for somebody else's problem, but he can give you peace for the problem that you have in your life right then and there. Amen. And the fourth reason for storms in our life is number four, that storms that we are dragged into by other people. And this is a type of storm that Paul found himself in our scripture reading in Acts the 27th chapter tonight. Can I tell us tonight that there are five ways to sink a ship? There's five ways that you can sink a ship. You can make a bad decision, that you can ruin lives and destroy families by these five different ways. Number one, you make a decision in haste. Everybody say speedy decisions. Speedy decisions is always not a right answer. It's not a good remedy. You find that if you make a hasty decision while you're down, while you're in the mully grubs, it could be the worst decision you ever make. Amen. It can ruin your life. It can be a decision that destroys your family. That's why you never make a decision while you're in the mully grubs, while you're down, while things are going against you, while you're in the middle of the storm. Don't make a decision then. Wait until you've come through the storm and then make a decision. Amen. Number two, you will sink your ship if you depend on worldly wisdom rather than God's wisdom. Was it not Isaiah that recorded in the words of the Lord, recorded the words of the Lord? And he said, woe to them that go down to Egypt for help. Woe to them that trust in horses and chariots of men. What Isaiah was saying is, don't put your trust in man's ability, but put your trust in God's ability and what you have read and seen and heard that God can do. Help us tonight, God, not to make a hasty decision, and let us not trust in man's wisdom instead of your wisdom. Number three, you will sink your ship if you take the easy way out. Everybody say, take the easy way out. The easiest thing for you and I to do is to find the easy way out and to take it. That's not always the right way. And can I tell you, it's for sure not God's way. The easiest thing for you to do when things are coming against you and you're in the middle of the storm is just throw up your hands and quit. I've seen people that have lived for God for years, that when things of life begin to go contrary to the way that they want it to go or the way they expect it to go, I've seen them lose their walk with God simply because they just quit. They just quit. Don't quit when things are going, number one, don't quit, period. But don't quit when things are going wrong in your life, because you want things to go from bad to worse. It's going to happen then. Amen. Thank God that we've got some bulldog determination. Thank God that we understand that when things go wrong and we don't have no other rope, nothing else to hold on to, what we're going to do is we're going to tie a knot in the rope that we're hanging on to, and we're just going to hang there for a while. We're just going to hold on for a while. I don't feel God right now, but you will. I don't see God right now, but you will. Even when I don't see God working, he's working. When I don't feel God in my life, he's still a part of my life. When I don't know where God's at, I'm glad that he's still right there beside me. So five ways to ruin or to sink your ship and to make a bad decision, ruin your life, destroy your family. You make a decision in haste. You trust in worldly wisdom rather than in godly wisdom. You'll sink your ship if you take the easy way out. And number four, you will sink your ship if you just simply follow the crowd. Amen. Let's just do what everybody else is doing. Wrong answer. Let's just do what everybody else is doing. Don't do that. Let's just follow the crowd and let the crowd lead us. Don't do that. You're going to ruin your life. You're going to destroy your family. You're going to lose your walk with God. The Bible talks about the blind leading the blind. And what does it say? If the blind leads the blind, they both fall in the ditch. Don't go the way that everybody else is going. Just because they're going that way doesn't make it right. Just because they chose that way doesn't make it right. It doesn't make it the right way. Don't follow the crowd. Number five, you'll sink your ship if you just depend on circumstances, and you'll sink the ship. The Word of God tells us in Ecclesiastes 3, it says, in his time, he hath made all things beautiful. Beautiful. Everybody say beautiful. In his time, he hath made all things beautiful. Don't depend on circumstances. Well, and I know a lot of people that say, well, if such and such happens, then I'm going to make my decision to do such and such. You're basing your decision on what other people are doing. You can't do that. You can't do that. Don't depend on what their circumstances are and how they came through the storm, but take it back to the Word of God and find out what the Word of God says and how the Word of God says that we are to act and do and be in the middle of a storm. And so, somewhere you've got to learn to trust in the Lord and not trust in the circumstances. It's in Proverbs, the 3rd chapter and the 5th verse. The Bible says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall, everybody say shall. He shall direct thy paths. Five easy ways to sink your ship. Make a decision in haste. You'll sink your ship if you depend on worldly wisdom rather than godly wisdom. You'll sink the ship if you take the easy way out. You'll sink the ship if you just follow the crowd. Or you'll sink the ship if you just depend upon circumstances instead of a trust in God. Number two, you find that the reason for the storms, number two, is you find the reaction to the storms. You find in Acts the 27th chapter and the 14th through the 21st verse, it deals with Paul and the storm. It deals with the decision that they made. It deals with how they reacted in the middle of the storm. Notice verse number 15. The Bible says, we let her drive. In other words, we let it go. What does it mean? It means it was out of control. They had done everything in their wisdom and their knowledge of trying to come out of a storm or to sail through the storm. You find that they had done everything that they knew, and finally they just had to come to realize the fact that they just had to let it drive. They couldn't bear up. Can I tell you, there's going to be times that you will not be able to bear up underneath the load, that you've just got to let things take its course and let it go. But what you can do is trust that you've got a God that knows exactly where you're at, and he knows what you're going through. Amen. It means they couldn't handle it. Can I tell you, sometimes we just can't handle life. We can't handle life. We've got to give it to God. We've got to let God take control. The devil will tell you that it's hard for you to live for God. But understand this, the Bible says he is the father of all lies. He's the father of all lies. He'll tell you you can't live for God. If you live for God hard, it's going to be easy. If you live for God easy, it's going to be hard. Sink in for a moment. If you live for God hard, it's going to be easy. But if you live for God easy, it's going to be hard. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying if you get into your life, into living for God, and you get into it with everything you've got, and you've got your mind made up, and you get the concept of let this mind be in me, which was also in Christ Jesus. If you get a hold of that concept of God, let me lose my mind and let me take upon the mind of Christ, the devil's going to tell you that you can't live for God and you can't make it. But you hear this, preacher, I've been in this too long, and I've come to understand that it doesn't matter how hard things get, we can live for God and we can make it and we can trust in God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. And so you find the reason, you find the reaction to the storms of life. And I made mention just a few moments ago that your attitude toward the storm determines your altitude in the storm. You can get above the storm. Hello? I said you can get above the storm. You find that many times that airplanes, when they take off, and except the ones that fly into Lake Charles, the ones that fly into Lake Charles, they never have a way of getting above the storm. Always have to stay in the storm, and so they cancel everything. Evan has been scheduled to fly out twice out of Lake Charles and meet us in California when we were out there. And both times that he was scheduled to fly out of Lake Charles, the storm came. Well, one time the storm kept him out of Lake Charles, kept him in Houston, and we had to have someone come from Lake Charles to pick him up in the storm because they couldn't fly into Lake Charles. And so someone came and picked him up because he had to be at work at 4:30 the next morning. And then there was another time that they canceled all flights. They'd canceled all inbound flights at that time. Another time that he was scheduled to be with us in California, and they canceled everything going out of Lake Charles into Houston because there was a storm between Lake Charles and Houston. It wasn't even in Lake Charles yet, but it was coming. Can I tell you, sometimes we know a storm's coming, but what we've got to do is we've got to get off the ground and get above the storm. I've been flying at times from Houston to the West Coast or to Arizona, and the pilot, the light would come on to take your seat, please, and to keep your seat belt fastened. And the reason they said that is because we were going to go through some turbulent travel. We were going to go through some places where that would hit some of those air pockets and the plane would drop. Well, there was a couple times we hit some of those air pockets that I really thought I was dropping all the way. You know, I pray before I ever get to the airport, before I ever get on the plane, and then I pray as we're taxiing, and I say, God, if there's anything that's going to take place on this plane, anything negative, I said, I want you to go ahead and don't even let us get off the ground. Just stop us right now. Hey, I like to fly, but I don't want to, you know, I don't want it to be somebody else's time to go meet the Lord while we're up in the air. And I definitely don't want it to be the pilot's time. Amen. That's not the time for you to pray for the Lord to take the pilot. I mean, I want the Lord to pilot the plane, but you know, I kind of like the wisdom that he gives men to pilot it too, you know. And so, this last time that we flew out to California and was on our way back, I remember hitting some of those pockets and all of a sudden, without warning, I mean, the plane just dropped and everybody went. And I was one of those that went because my heart was still up here and my body was down here. You know, you don't like those turbulent times. You don't like those turbulent times. But we can make it through them. And we're only going to make it through it by the helping grace of God. And if we trust in God. And I'm closing. The result of the storms. Was it God's plan that the ship sail? No. God told them not to sail. Paul told them not to sail. Paul told them that it was wrong for them to set sail. But that did not stop God's ultimate plan for Paul. Decisions other people make that involves you cannot stop God's will for your life. What God does not rule, God overrules. Can I tell you tonight that it doesn't matter what the devil creates to destroy you with, God has the ultimate say, and he can overrule any storm that's in your life. The devil devises a storm to destroy us, Pastor. But God can take that same storm and he can cause it to be a blessing to us. And he can cause it to feed us. I'm talking about riding through the storm. Every bad decision that the captain of the ship made and all the other people that were part of that voyage that day, it could not abort the will of God for the Apostle Paul. Can I tell you tonight that every decision that other people make trying to destroy your walk with God and your relationship with God, it cannot abort the will of God for your life. God's able to bring you through anything. I said God's able to bring you through anything. The Bible talks about Job and it talks about all the horrible things that happened to Job. But it says after this lived Job. God expects us to live after every storm in our life. He expects us to live. He doesn't expect the storm to destroy you. He expects you to trust in him, and he'll bring you through every dark place in your life. Can we stand to our feet and lift our hands, and let's thank God. that he allows things to happen that strengthen us. He allows things to come our way that encourages us. Even though the storms at times, the devil means to destroy us with them, I'm thankful that God's able to help us through it and make us make it through to the other side. Come on, hallelujah. Thank you, God, that we can ride out any storm that's in our life. Thank you that we're able to come through anything that comes against us, God, because greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. Thank you for being that very present help in time of need, God. In time of trouble, you've always been there for us, and we appreciate everything that you're doing. Thank you for being the master of the storm in our life, God. Thank you for being there when the sun's shining, but thank you for being there when the dark clouds come and the rain comes and the thunder roars and the lightning flashes. Thank you for being there by our side to take us through it, God. We love you tonight. We worship you. We give you glory. We give you praise. We give you honor in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's put our hands together and give him a good hand clap of praise tonight. Come on. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to God. Glory to God. You know what I want us to do in closing? And I like the way that we close out every service like this. And it doesn't matter if it's Sunday morning, Sunday night, it's Wednesday night tonight, but we're still going to close it out. Why don't we come and stand around the front just for a few moments? We've still got about 2 or 3 minutes before the kids all get out. Why don't we just come and stand and let's ask God, God, help us to ride out the storms. Help us to trust in you in the middle of the storms. Help us not to make a bad decision that can ruin lives, God, but help us to trust in your wisdom and your direction, God, that will lead and guide and direct us into all truth, God. Hallelujah, hallelujah.